Good evening, everyone. Hello from Boston, Massachusetts, very far away from San Francisco. But I wanted to start by saying I'm actually a native of the Bay Area, and I really do miss the developments in Filipino cuisine that are going on back in the Bay. One of the things that has blown me away ever since I moved away in 2006 is just how on the cutting edge the Filipino food scene is in the Bay Area compared to the rest of the country. And when I was writing this book, I would constantly refer back to what was going on in San Francisco as the benchmark of what is possible when American eaters and American diners and American thinkers and the American public is able to reckon with the history of food and the history of American empire at the same time. When I was putting the talk together, I wanted to try and reframe it with using the feedback that I've received over the last couple of years when the book came out in 2000 on the direct relevancy for this historical story. So as I was thinking about it, I wanted to answer this question in four parts. How does Filipino food's past in the US inform its present? Or subtitle, the misconceptions and racism that has shaped Filipino food in the United States, going back to the turn of the century, 1898, and the Spanish-American War, all the way to the present day. And I wanted to start that story by taking a look at the Bay Area. I'm, as I was saying off the top, continually amazed by the fact that you have developments such as this, KQED writing about the face of San Francisco's modern Filipino food movement having his own restaurant in the city. Images such as this, that the Sarap Shop is both a food truck and a food stall and a brick and mortar location in the middle of the Chase Center, uniting all the passions that Filipino Americans have, the Golden State Warriors, basketball, and food. You type in Filipino food in San Francisco and you get a bunch of hits on Google, things that weren't around when I first started doing the research for this work in 2006. And if you zoom it out even further into the Bay Area, you see it up and down the Bay. And speaking as a San Jose native and a South Bay native, they totally got that wrong. If you go into Santa Clara County, there must be at least 20 different restaurants that are serving Filipino food. All of which is preamble for the thing that blows me away, that like it's so popular today, but if you go back to the 1900s and the start of the American period with the end of the Spanish-American War, it's a completely different reception to Filipino food that's going on within the American public. In books such as this, from a work called Our Islands and Our People, which is published in 1899, you get a description of Filipino food that reads something like this. A Filipino restaurant. This restaurant is located in the suburbs of Manila and is representative of its class. It's a rare thing to see a pleasant face among these people. As a race, they are vindictive and treacherous. Just the kind of people that all good Americans desire to keep away from. What I want to argue is that you can answer this question of how does Filipino food's past inform its present by looking at four different things. The American closed-mindedness that greeted Filipinos at the start of the 1900s, conceptions about race, class, and immigration, the playing of the imperial game as Americans are competing with European powers in Southeast Asia, and the use of food and war and propaganda during the American period in the Philippines. Okay, so we're looking primarily at the turn of the century up until 1946. Start with the first one, American closed-mindedness. The thing about American cuisine that we like to celebrate today is that it's accepting, that it takes in influences from all the different parts of society. The melting pot, you know, the proverbial melting pot that comes from food, expressed in the restaurant menus and the kinds of tastes that are going on in the United States. But there have been very, very strong closed-mindedness when the Philippines and the United States start interacting at the turn of the century. And you can see it in sources such as this, 1922's Good Cooking and Health in the Tropics. It's a cookbook published by Mrs. Samuel Francis Gatschis, registered nurse, or Elsie Gatschis. She's the ex-directress of nurses and principal of the Philippine General Hospital School of Nursing in the Philippines. So pretty high up there. And you can see like from this first cookbook published by Americans in the Philippines with the intention of trying to reform Filipino cuisine, Filipino recipes are segregated, pages 15 to 32, in a cookbook that's 175 pages. Right? There's a little bit of other non-Filipino but Asian cuisines, like Spanish, Filipino, miscellaneous Oriental recipes, pages 33 to 51. But the point is, it's a really small and segregated selection of recipes that are targeting Americans as like, this is the Filipino stuff in the middle of the Philippines, right? After what, the better part of 20 years, there's still a push to push as much American food as possible, but minimize the Filipino food in a cookbook such as this. But it's not just the recipes. It's also a cookbook that reflects the racial attitudes that Americans had towards Filipinos at the time. You'll see passages such as this that's talking about how Americans are trying to uplift or do the benevolent uplift of Filipinos. There are no servants in the world so willing and anxious to submit to any medical treatment or to conform so quickly to the teaching of hygiene, if by so doing it will bring them robust health, as are the Filipinos. It may prove a little expensive in the beginning, but it is a very satisfying feeling to know that healthy people are serving us, and surely it is a noble charity to give this class of people health. So you see the paternalism that's dripping in this statement here. A little bit further on in the book, you'll see this, talking about how to train domestic help Filipino workers that are serving in these American homes in the Philippines. While teaching the new boy how to keep the kitchen clean, explain to him why this is so important. It will be necessary to continue the instruction for some time. And then when he knows how to do the work, never fail to inspect the kitchen and make sure it is all right. Invite your friends to inspect your kitchen. Nothing will make the cook or the kitchen boy feel prouder or work harder than to know you're going to do this. Dripping in paternalism. And it's ironic that there's such a strong American closed-mindedness to Filipino cuisine when you consider what Filipino cuisine is. It's constitutive of influences from Spain, influences from the New World, influences from China, influences from Southeast Asia, even influences from the Middle East. It's arguably the most diverse food in Southeast Asia, maybe even the world, because going back to the Spanish galleon trades in the 16th century, all the way until the American arrival in 1898, you've got a huge multi-ethnic, multicultural entrepot in Manila that's drawing from around the world. The food anthropologist, cultural anthropologist, scholar Doreen Fernandez at Ateneo had this to say about how to describe Filipino cuisine. It was a conscious and yet unconscious cultural reaction in that borrowers knew that they were cooking foreign dishes while making necessary adaptations, but were not aware that they were transforming the dish and making it their own. In other words, Filipino cuisine is the ultimate example and the ultimate action of agency in transforming cuisine and indigenizing from around the world. So there's American closed-mindedness that's completely antithetical to the ways that Filipinos have been creating their own cuisine for the better part of four centuries by the time the Americans arrived, which is why the way that Americans use food to define race, class, and immigration was so stifling. It didn't give agency. If anything, it imposed a very structured and hierarchical way of viewing the world that had been ingrained in American empire all the way back to the middle of the 19th century. You'll see images, something along the images of American Indians, American Native Americans, in something like this. This is a famous image from the Carlisle Indian School from 1882 and 1886. Before and after images of a Native American man named Tom Torlino that were undergirded by this belief by Richard Pratt, the superintendent of the Carlisle Indian School, that these acculturation centers and education were really in the service of one thing, to kill the Indian and to save the man. And the thing that when I teach my 19th century American history classes, that a lot of students aren't aware of is that this isn't just limited to the American West. This isn't just limited to the American Native American. If anything, it's wherever Americans are going abroad during this period after the Spanish-American War. You see this happening in the Philippines. You have this image from 1914 by a work by Dean Worcester, who was one of the principal leaders of the American mission in the Philippines. With an image titled "The Metamorphosis of a Bontoc Igorot." So two photographs of Pita Pit, a Bontoc Igorot boy. The second was taken 9 years after the first, right? This is the Native American version. This is the Filipino version. It's the same thing that's going on. Once Filipino students graduate from school, they enter into a marketplace. They enter into the general public. They become consumers. And they enter into a consumer literature in the 1920s that's pushing Americanization through products, and specifically through food products such as this. This is an ad for Nabisco from 1933. And what you can see when you're just looking at the artwork and the clip art is strong iconography for American government. There's an image of George Washington. There's an image of the US Capitol building. There's images of the Stars and Stripes. If you take a look at, if this were in color, you would see that it is in red, white, and blue. And if you translate out the Tagalog into the English of what this ad is saying, you see that it says this: the Washington Soda Biscuit is a product of the National Biscuit Company, the mark that brings you excellence in quality in every can of Washington. In other words, these ads are trying to make an association of product hierarchies, product quality, and the superiority of American goods over Filipino goods to a Filipino public that's reading in Tagalog in 1933, 30 years after the start of the American period. We're deep into the Americanization of the Filipino marketplace. It's not just Nabisco, however, it's basically every American food company that's entering into the company, or they're entering into the Philippines. This is 1926 from Li Yiyi, one of the popular middle-class magazines at the time, for Del Monte. And if you translate out the Tagalog into English, you'll see this: fresh from the fruit farms of sunny California to your home, you can have ripe and juicy fruit in your home thanks to Del Monte. You probably read about the rich and the fruit of the farms of the California, with good cherries, grapes, and peaches that are super abundant. You open a can of Del Monte Queen Anne cherries, loved and picked at the full maturity of their taste, beneficial and wholesome for you. Hand them to your children for dessert. Always have to be home sweet desserts. Make sure it's true Del Monte, the best. Go and try one now. This may seem somewhat benign. You know, it's just ad copy, just filling out expectations and trying to nail down that this is healthy, that this is happy, that like your kids will like it. But it's missing something really, really obvious. This is in 1926, which is right at the height, you know, like right before the crackdown in 1935. Of Filipino immigration from the Philippines into the United States. This is after the clampdown and immigration from Asia during the Asian Exclusion Acts and the Immigration Act of 1921 and 1924. In other words, these Del Monte cherries, which were picked somewhere in Central California and then canned somewhere in Monterey and made their way across the Pacific to the Philippines, were most likely picked by Filipino migrant workers. And there's not any hint of that in that advertisement. You look at the illustrations in there, and like the only taste of or hint that there's a Filipino representation is the targeted audience at the bottom right corner, the Filipino mom and her child walking into a Baha'i kubo. Otherwise, this is like a straight argumentation for the quality of American goods packed in corn syrup and then shipped over the Pacific to the Philippines, selling canned goods to Filipinos who have access to tropical goods as a better alternative. It's actually very, very unsettling when you think about it in its historical context. You've got ads for Heinz tomato ketchup, a condiment that's popular around the world, but in 1926 is trying to find its audience in the Philippines. And you have the enlistment of Filipino iconography to try and make this American good that's with a company that's based in Pittsburgh into a good that's familiar in Manila. And you have the translation from Tagalog to English of enjoy the quite delicious taste of Heinz tomato ketchup on your food. Enjoy the taste if you mix it with soup, meat, fish, rice, and other common foods in Filipino homes. You'll always have a bottle at the table at mealtime, available to buy at stores. And if that was enough to convince you, you have some images that will be familiar if you're Filipino. You have palm trees, you have a lechon, you have a bahay kubo, you have poros during Christmas time, and you have people cooking outdoors in the dirty kitchen, something that warms my heart when I think about it in my trips back home. This kind of mentality is so endemic in the Philippines that it starts to shape how Filipinos are considering their ads for the Filipino public. This is a Magnolia ice cream ad from, I believe it's 1926, 1927. I wish I had my notes in front of me. You get a sense of what they're trying to pitch here. Americanness, Americanness through whiteness, an image that's supposed to be representative of someone like Shirley Temple. And Magnolia, which is a company that's publicly traded now, it's a company that still exists, it's arguably the most powerful company in the Philippines, because it's partnered up with San Miguel, has this advertisement. My complexion cream is none other than delicious Magnolia certified pure ice cream. And this is where the health claims and the racialism and the mixing of all of those things into a weird imperial stew comes to the fore. Beauty without health is impossible. And I have proved from experience that Magnolia ice cream contains so many of the essentials of a well-balanced diet that health and beauty come naturally to those who eat it regularly. When you see a lovely girl whose rosy cheeks glow with well-being and whose eyes sparkle with radiant health, depend on it, she never says no to Magnolia. Again, this is an American company. This is a company that's based in Manila, using the techniques of American advertising to promote itself, not as a Filipino company, but as a company that's going to help along with complexion, with whiteness, with that ideal from the empire. Playing the imperial game. How does food present itself and form our understanding of food in the Filipino-American relationship? You can see it in the kinds of menus that Americans are creating during the 1910s and the 1920s that are trying to show themselves as people that are refined, people that are able to match the culinary quality of places like France, places like the UK, places like Germany. And what you see, an example such as this, 1907, the United States flagship Rainbow, one of the naval ships that's serving in Cavite, is the appearance of being French, the appearance of presenting a menu that's just as at home in New York or San Francisco as it would be in Paris. And you have things like that you would find in a traditional like French restaurant, caviar à la russe, amount sauce, olive, bouillon, and sauce à la crevette. Like basically like the stuff that you'd find at a French bistro. But the thing that jumps out to me, at least, when I look at this menu is that there's multiple, I counted nine when I looked at it really closely, grammatical, syntax errors, like errors in French, like basic French grammar that this is getting wrong. In other words, it's more important to present the air of Frenchness, the air of Europeanism, the air of being able to compete with Europe than it is to be accurate. So they're trying to play, American menus are trying to play at being French before they're trying to be at being American. You even see this in the back of that menu and the program of music that's being played. You have an overture, Poet and Peasant by Soup, Fantasia's Faust by Gounod, Short, Mascagni, Donizetti, Verdi, Tobani, Morse, no Filipino composers, only one American composer, but a bunch of stuff that you would see in operettas that were popular at the time period. So playing at empire means being able to understand what the continental Europeans are embracing at the same time, and you stamp it in the food and you stamp it in the music. You'll see the same kind of work happening in a menu from 1899. January 27th of 1899 in Manila, the Casino Union's menu commemorating the birthday of Senior Major Kaiser Wilhelm II of the German Empire, right? So you'll see that they're serving asparagus soup, fish with kartoffeln, ham and Burgundy, sauerkraut, sirloin with vegetables, young goose with salad, cheese, cake, fruit, coffee, nothing from the Philippines. Again, like no representation of the country that they are working in, the country that they are colonizing, the country that they've been living in as colonizers. By the time you get to 1927, you have an ad in something like the Manila Carnival Commercial and Industrial Fair. It was basically the World's Fair for the Philippines in 1927. And this ad makes very explicit what the best restaurants, the best hotels, the best accommodation in the country you're trying to do, offering every American comfort and luxury. In other words, make a new America in the middle of the Philippines, in the middle of Manila, in the Manila Hotel, a building that's actually sponsored by the Philippine American government that's paid for by Philippine taxpayers in order to create something that would rival the Raffles in Singapore or one of these other hotels in Southeast Asian capitals of empire at the same time. I believe that warm propaganda is one of the more interesting ways of looking at how food is presenting itself. Because you see, by the time the Philippine-American War rolls around, this belief that menus in the Philippines and menus in the United States could actually summon American support for the Philippine-American War. You have examples such as this, the Stanton House in Chattanooga, Tennessee, where you'll have things like boiled Kennebec salmon sauce Philippine. Chattanooga, Tennessee, I've been there many times because I have an aunt that lived there. It's about as far as you get from Washington, D.C., or from San Francisco, or any of the traditional areas that you would associate with the Philippine-American War and empire. But even there, like in order to drill up, to drum up support for the Philippine-American War, you have menus such as this that are serving a sauce Philippine. In other words, the Philippine-American War is going on, let's commemorate it at Thanksgiving. You have menus such as this one from Delmonico's in 1900. So the Philippine-American War is strongly going on. And at the premier restaurant in New York City, the premier restaurant in the country, at Delmonico's, you have a dinner for Major General L.L.S. Otis, one of the guys that was actually relieved of his command for committing war crimes and atrocities against Filipinos in the Philippine-American War. And here again, you'll see like nods to the Philippine conflict, not necessarily to Filipino food. Consomme de Philippine, Sorbet au Kirsch, and that's one of the American generals that serves during the war. Risa a la Menina, and Aguilette de Semen a la Luzon. So places in the Philippines, but not necessarily food of the Philippines. And this is in honor of a guy that's getting relieved of command for being an essential character, an essential figure in things like this, the Balangiga Massacre, where there was an order that was given out to all American soldiers to kill everyone, every boy, every Filipino man in Balangiga over the age of 10. So this is a political cartoon at the time saying criminals because they were born 10 years before we took the Philippines. This obviously did not go over well for the American public, to the American public. Teddy Roosevelt immediately starts moving forward the negotiations to end the war because public opinion is turned. Because things like this, these food menus that are trying to drum up support, are coming up against the truth of warfare. That truth of the warfare looks something like this. There were 126,000 American soldiers who were sent, 6,165 were killed, and 2,818 were wounded. In the Philippines, there are 20,000 Filipino soldiers who were killed, and 250,000 Filipino civilians that were killed, which is a pretty stunning statistic because the country's population is something like 5 or 6 million at the time, which means that 1 in 20 Filipino civilians was killed during the Philippine-American War. It's such an unpopular war within a year that you have figures in American literature or in American intellectualism, such as Mark Twain, writing an essay called To the Person Sitting in Darkness, an anti-imperial essay where he writes that the American exceptionalism, this belief that America is spreading democracy, is a farce. He proposes this instead. As for a flag for the Philippine province, it's easily managed. We can have just our usual flag with the white stripes painted black and the stars replaced by the skull and crossbones. This isn't a happy vision or happy version of the United States. It's actually one that we have to be incredibly critical of because it's doing work in the name of imperialism, in the name of betterment of Filipinos that's antithetical to American values. It's not a long jump then to see Mark Twain's criticisms of American actions in the Philippines and the reflections of a Filipino living in the United States 30 years later. This is probably the most famous work of Filipino American literature, certainly the most important one when discussing a firsthand portrayal of what Filipinos are enduring in the 1920s and the 1930s in California. Carlos Bulosan's America's in the Heart. About a third of the way through the book, after he's arrived in California, after he had been raised in Pangasinan, believing that there was an American dream, he comes up against a true reality. I came to know afterwards that in many ways, it was a crime to be a Filipino in California. I came to know that the public streets were not free to my people. We were stopped each time these vigilant patrolmen saw us driving a car. We were suspect each time we were seen with a white woman. And perhaps it was this narrowing of our life into an island, into a filthy segment of American society that had driven Filipinos inward, hating everyone, despising all the positive urgencies towards freedom. It's a pretty harrowing way to live one's life, and it starts to make one want to separate themselves from the United States. That's the context that blows me away when I see the popularity of Filipino food in the United States today. It's totally different from the reception that Bonosan had as a Filipino working in California, living in California, trying to escape poverty and violence in California for the better part of his adult life. And it's one that's actually not that far removed, that is not that far removed, even in the recent histories. So this is probably one of the more interesting sources for me. It's from the LA Times in 1968. It's by Barbara Hansen. And it's a close examination of the Philippine Consulate General who's living in Los Angeles at the time. And it's ostensibly a story about Filipino cuisine. There's even a couple of references to Filipino adobo. I believe there's a recipe for palitao at the end. But when you get down into the text, you actually see that the Philippine Consular General at the time, the man who's in charge of spreading the Philippines' best interests in the United States after independence in 1946, was ashamed to share Filipino food with non-Filipinos. This is the quotation. "We usually take foreigners out to dinner. We have hesitated to serve them Filipino food because we're not sure of their reaction," said Mrs. Faustino. So even someone that's tasked with representing the Philippines as best as they can, as a representative of the Philippine nation, is afraid to share Filipino food with non-Filipinos. So we've really gone a long way from that imperial mindset that's making Filipinos 60 years ago afraid to share their food to this Filipino-American food world that's booming in places like San Francisco, places that are unique, and places that are much more embracing of foreign cultures and more mindful of what those cultures have been through in order to be a part of this culinary stew that is American cuisine. And my book talks a little bit about that. It's a little sampling of what's in there. Thank you, everyone, for coming to the talk.